चल इट्स नॉट ऑडिबल सर.
नॉट ऑडिबल.
नो सर.
वन सेकंड. It's not audible from starting or in between it's gone.
Starting, sir.
Students?
From starting it was not audible, sir.
Roll number 2, can you respond?
From starting it was not audible, sir.
Is low and maintenance cost is
now
more in case of the.
Yes, sir. Now it's audible.
And here, in case of jet condenser, the turbine medium. Okay. Now, so if you compare in jet condenser, there will be direct contact, and in surface condenser, it won't be indirect contact. Okay. And condensation is due to mixing of cooling water, and here the condensation is due to heat transfer by conduction and convection. As already discussed in boilers, even it's similar to boiler only. In boiler, water is flowing through the tubes. Let us take water tube boiler. Water is flowing through the tubes, and outside the water is exposed to outside the tubes are exposed to the hot gases due to the conduction and convection heat transfer takes place. The same principle here. Condensation is due to the heat transfer by conduction and convection. Here, condensation here by using jet condenser, the condensate cannot be reused because any dust particle, any foreign material, any gases present, we cannot reuse. So, whereas in case of surface condenser, it is pure because there is no physical contact, so we can reuse it as the feed water. So, okay, now it is cheap and does not affect the plant efficiency in case of jet condenser. Whereas in case of surface condenser, it is costly. Because you need to install the system, and it also improves the plant efficiency. And there is no maintenance cost in case of jet condenser. It is low, and the maintenance cost is more in case of the surface condenser. And here, in case of jet condenser, the vacuum created is less, 600 mm Hg. Here, the vacuum created is more, that is 730 mm. You can use surface condenser. Means more time available for the steam to expand in the turbine. If you use this jet condenser, you can expand till 600 only. It is 730 is more than 600. Means if you use surface condenser, the turbine work is also increased. Okay. Now we'll discuss what are different types of jet condensers. So basically, jet condensers are of three types. So one is the low level jet condenser, and the second is the high level jet condenser, and third is ejector jet condenser. Again, low-level jet condenser is of two types based on the flow of the water and the steam, exhaust steam. So, counterflow and parallel flow. As we know the name, counterflow means both exhaust steam and water are moving in the opposite direction. Okay. Whereas in case of parallel flow, the exhaust steam and water both are moving in one direction. Now, we will see why the name it is low-level jet condenser. So, here, the low-level jet condenser means here the condenser is placed at low elevation. The condenser is placed at the low elevation and the overall height of the unit is low so that the condenser may be directly placed below the steam turbine. And in order to extract the condensate, a pump is required. Okay. And one more air pump is also required to remove the non-condensable gases. Now you see low level counterflow jet injector or condenser. Okay. Now you can see here, this is the condenser, and from here, from the side, the exhaust steam is entered, and this is the cooling pond. From here, the cooling water is circulated. Okay, now the cooling water is entering at the top, and because of the density more, now we can see here perforated trays. Perforated trays, there are small holes are there for the trays because we are giving time for the water to travel. It means it like obstruction, okay, perforated tray. So the water is first injected at the top, through the perforated trays, the cooling water is coming downward direction. Okay, as the steam density is less, it starts moving upward direction. So in the passage, the water is coming downward direction and the steam is moving in the upward direction. Both are mixing here, thereby the condensation is taking place and the condensate is collected at the top. And any non-condensable gases present during the condensation process, they will be escaped through the air extraction pump. They can be removed by using air extraction pump. And this condensate we are collecting by using condensate extraction pump, because it is installed at the low level, because the height you can see it is 5.5 meter. 5.5 meter is below the atmosphere, because one atmospheric head is equals to 10.3 meter. It is the less than that. Therefore, in order to remove the condensate, so you need to create the pressure difference. For that, we are using the condensate extraction pump. So from this, we can use the water to the boiler, and at the same time, some excess water we can go use for the cooling purpose. So this is low level counter flow condenser. Got it? So one thing you should remember, that the height is 5.5 meter. It is less than atmosphere. We know that one atmospheric pressure head, H is equals to 10.3 meter. It is less than that. That's why you're using the condensate extraction pump. You may have doubt why you are using pump. You can directly discharge. It cannot discharge because the pressure here is vacuum pressure. Okay, this is vacuum pressure. Inside the pond we have, it is open to the atmosphere. Therefore, it is atmospheric pressure. So the water cannot be directly discharged unless until some pump is installed here. Okay, now second one, low level parallel flow. Here counter flow means from the top water is entering, from the bottom steam is entering. So exactly opposite that. So parallel flow means both. So this is the animated view of that counter flow. We can see here the steam is entering here from the side, and the water we are injecting at the top. From the top, the water is moving downward direction. So in that passage, it is mixing with the steam and it will get condensed. And that condensate extraction pump is used to remove the condensate from the condenser, and that will be stored in the well. Okay, and from there we can use it for the boiler. And here we are using air to remove the non-condensable gases present inside the condenser. Okay, this is the animated view how the flow takes place. This is the cooling water, and this is the steam, and this is the condensate. Now this is the parallel flow jet condenser. Now, as the name indicates, that exhaust steam and cooling water both are moving in one direction. Okay, this is the condenser. This is the exhaust steam from the turbine, and this is the cooling water. So both are moving in downward direction. While moving, the condensation is taking place. That condensate can be removed by using this condensate extraction pump. Okay, so the pumps are two types: wet pump and dry pump. Dry pump means it is used to remove the air, and wet pump we can use for the condensate. Now high level, second type of jet condenser, high level jet condenser, we can call it as barometric condenser. So why we are calling it as high means it is installed above the atmosphere. Means the height you can see it is 10.33 meters, almost equivalent to the atmosphere. Means if the pressure is above the atmosphere or equivalent to atmosphere, need not to use any pump to remove the condensate. That's why you can see here the condensate extraction pump is eliminated, because the height you can see here mentioned, the tailpipe height is 10.33. It is like almost equal to the atmospheric pressure head. Therefore, condensate directly will discharge into the hot well. The otherwise the remaining everything will be same. Only difference is here, earlier it was 5 meter. Now the height is increased to 10.3 meter to easily discharge the condensate. Here the pump is eliminated. Condensate extraction pump is eliminated. Remaining everything is similar. So here we are using the cooling water. That water is circulated to the top of the condenser. From there the water is discharged through the perforated trays. So in that way the steam is entering at the side. It is moving upward direction. When the steam is moving upward direction, it is in contact with the downcoming water. Thereby the condensation is taking place, and non-condensable gases can be removed by using air extraction pump, and the condensate is directly discharged into the hot well. From there we can send it to the boiler. Okay, so this is the high level jet condenser. And third type of jet condenser is ejector type jet condenser. So here in this ejector jet condenser, the water is entering at the top and steam is entering from the side. It is, you can see, it is a non-return valve, means the flow will take place only in one direction. The reversal is not possible. Here you can see a series of nozzles. This series of nozzles, so cold water nozzle. When the water is flowing through the nozzle, its velocity is increasing. So, okay, because of increasing its momentum. So when the body is projected downward direction, before reaching the ground, its velocity is increased due to the gravity. The same way, the water velocity is keep on increasing, thereby vacuum will be created here. So the incoming steam is mixing with the water. This water is having high velocity, thereby the condensation is taking place here. So due to that, vacuum is created. Therefore, more steam will be injected into this. And here, due to the vacuum and condensation is taking place. Here, the pressure is less than the atmosphere. In order to discharge it, you should increase the pressure. That's why this condensate is allowed to pass through the divergent passage. When it is passing through the divergent passage, due to increase in its area, pressure will be increased. Therefore, it can easily discharge it. From there, we can collect the condensate and this can be reused. Okay, this is about the jet condenser. So far we discussed three types of jet condensers: low level, high level and ejector type condenser. This is about the jet condenser. Now we will go.
Students, any doubt in jet condensers? Very, very important. We discussed so far three types of condensers: low level. So under low level, we discussed parallel flow and counter flow. Okay, so those are depends upon the direction of the flow. If the steam coming from the boiler and the water from the cooling tower both are entering in one direction, then we can call it as parallel flow. And if both the fluids, that is condensed, so the cooling water as well as the steam, are moving in the opposite direction, then we can say that they are counter flow condenser. Okay, no? So that is low level, high level. The difference between low level and high level is, in low level, the condenser is located at a height of 5.5 meters from the ground, that is the less than the atmospheric pressure head. That is the reason we are using condensate extraction pump to extract the condensate from the condenser. Whereas coming to the high level condenser, the condenser is located at a height of 10.33 meters from the ground. Therefore, it is equal to atmosphere. So there is no need of the condensate extraction pump. You need to mention these two very clearly, low level and high level. And lastly, we discussed about ejector type surface jet condenser. Students, please ask me if you have any doubt among these three. Jet type of condensers. Please respond.
So ejector type.
Ejector type. So in ejector type, if you see here, from the top, the water is coming. Okay, na? From the top, the water is coming, and from the left or from the side, the steam is entering into the condenser, right? So what is happening when the water is passing through the series of nozzles? When the water is passing through the series of nozzles, so why we are using more number of nozzles, means for mixing the, means to occur, to complete the condensation at a faster rate. Okay, so therefore what will happen when the water is passing through the nozzle, due to the decrease in area, means if you see the nozzle from inlet to outlet, the area is decreasing. Once the area decreases, automatically the velocity increases, right? Now, so therefore the mixing will be faster. Okay, so after mixing, after condensation, so what is happening, that is allowed to pass through the divergent portion, because in order to get discharge easily, so when it is passing through the divergent portion, that is when the area is increasing from inlet to outlet, what happens, the velocity will decrease and pressure will increase, thereby the condensate can be discharged easily without any external device. Okay, na? So this is the ejector type of jet condenser. Right, now we will discuss about surface condensers.
Go to the surface condenser. As we know, in surface condensers, there is no direct contact with the cooling water and the exhaust steam. Okay, there will be a barrier between. Okay, now you can see again, surface condensers are of two types: surface condensers and evaporative condenser. In surface condensers, the steam flows outside the tubes, and inside the tubes, cooling water will flow. It's similar to water tube boiler. In water tube boiler, what is happening? Water is flowing through the tubes. Outside the tubes are exposed to the hot flue gases. Here, instead of hot flue gases, it is the exhaust steam. Now, in this evaporative type, the steam passes through the tubes, and the water is sprayed while the air over the tubes. Mainly, it is similar to the 5-tube boiler. In 5-tube boiler, the flue gases are flowing through the tubes, and outside the tubes are exposed to the water. Similar to that, here the exhaust stream is allowed to pass through the tubes, and the cooling water is sprayed outside the tubes. Okay, now we'll discuss surface condensers. And
means here the surface condensers are similar to water tube boilers. Means the cold water is passing through the tubes, and outside the tubes are exposed to the steam releasing from the turbine. Whereas means the surface condensers are two types. One is the surface and second one is the evaporative. So in surface condenser, the water is cooling medium is flowing inside the tubes. Outside the tubes are exposed to the exhaust gas. Whereas in case of evaporative type is similar to the five tube boiler, where the steam exhausted from the turbine is passing through the tubes, and outside the tubes are surrounded by the condensed fluid. That is nothing but the cooling medium. So that the heat transfer will take place between the steam as well as the water, thereby the steam will get condensed. Because these surface condensers are comes under non-mixing type. Means the both are, there will be a barrier between the steam as well as the condensator medium. Okay.
Evaporative condenser. Both comes under surface condensers only. Okay. The classification of surface condensers are, it is single pass and multi-pass. Means how many times the water is passing through the condenser. Single pass and multi-pass. And based on the direction of the condensate, it is downflow and central flow. Okay. Now we'll discuss first what is single pass and what is multi-pass. Then we'll go to the downward flow and central flow. Right. Now you can see this is the condenser. And as we are discussing about surface condensers, in surface condensers, the water is flowing through the tubes, and outside the tube, the exhaust stream is in contact. Okay. Now you can see the cooling. This is the cooling water outlet, and this is the cooling water inlet. Okay. Now here the cooling water is moving from here to here. It is entering at the right end, and it is moving towards left end. What does it mean? How many passes it's over? One pass is completed. It enters here and it leaves here. Okay. If you use the condenser, it is a cooling water is entering here, cooling water is leaving here. Then I can call it as single pass. Got the point? Now here the cooling water is entering here. Again from here, one more entry here, one more exit. Means here it is two pass. There may be three pass, four pass, multi pass also. Okay. In single pass, cooling water enter from one end and it leaves at other end. So over the tubes, the exhaust stream is injected. Due to the heat transfer between the exhaust stream and the cooling water, here the exhaust stream will get condensed. What is happening when exhaust stream is in contact with the tubes? Due to the conduction and convection, condensation is happening, and the exhaust is the condensed steam is collected by using air pump. Wet air pump means it can suck condensate as well as the gases. Dry air pump means only it can suck wet. It can suck only condensate. Okay. So this is about the single pass, double, anything you can discuss here. If there is only one entry and one exit, it is, so if you consider only till here, this is single pass. If you consider two, it is double pass. There may be three passes also. We can call it as the multi-pass. Got it? So exhaust stream is entering from the top, and cooling water is passing through the tubes. Due to the conduction and convection, the exhaust stream will be condensed, and that will be collected at the bottom, and that can be used. Okay, because this can be used as the boiler feed water, because there is no physical contact between the exhaust stream and the cooling water. Okay. Now, evaporative condenser. In evaporative condensers, we have downflow and central flow. It's right. Now you can see this is the side view. So these circles are the tubes. Within the tubes, the cooling water is flowing. Okay. So outside the tube, the exhaust stream is in contact. So due to the heat exchange between the exhaust stream and the water, what will happen? The exhaust stream will be condensed, and that condensed steam is collected at the bottom, and any non-condensable gases present inside that one can be removed by using air extraction pump. The baffles are provided to allow the more heat exchanging. Okay. So more heat exchange will take place. Due to the baffle means more time available for the exhaust steam in contact with the tubes, thereby more amount of heat transfer will take place. That is the, so the steam is moving in the downward direction. That's why the name is called downflow surface condenser. Whereas in case of central flow condenser, so here the exhaust steam is moving down only, but here the condensation is taking place at the center. Air extraction pump is located at the center of the condenser tubes. The condensate is extracted from the bottom of the condenser with the help of the extraction pumps. Here provided better contact of the steam. Means here the steam is entering from the sides towards the center. So you can see these arrows means the entry of the steam. So therefore it is called central flow surface condenser. Okay. Now last one, evaporative condenser. So evaporative condenser, you can see, in surface condensers, the exhaust steam is passing over the tubes and inside the tubes cooling water is flowing. It is reverse that. Okay, means here the exhaust steam is passing through the tubes and outside the tubes are sprayed with the cooling water. Okay, so we can see this type of structure in the backside of the refrigerator. So inside the tubes your refrigerant is flowing, outside the tubes are exposed to the air in place of refrigerator. Here instead of air we are using the water, cooling water is spraying. You can see this is the exhaust steam from the turbine and it is passing through the tubes. And you can see here there are certain fins are provided. Okay, so fins will also increase the surface area, thereby heat transfer it is increased. Now from the water tank we are pumping the cooling water, the cooling water is entering at the top. From there we are spraying through the nozzles. So this water is in contact with the tubes. Okay, so thereby the heat exchange will take place from the exhaust steam to the water through the conduction as well as the convection. Thereby the steam is condensed and that condensate is collected at the bottom. Okay, so this is the evaporative condenser. So in surface condensers we discussed two categories, surface condenser and evaporative condenser. Again, the surface condensers are single flow, multi flow, central flow, and central flow and down flow. Okay, and evaporative condenser means there exhaust steam is passing through the tubes and outside the tubes are sprayed with the water. Okay, now you can see what are the advantages and disadvantages of jet condensers. Okay, so here jet condensers, anyhow there will be physical contact between the exhaust steam and the cooling water, therefore it cannot be reused as the boiler feed water. You can see less quantity of water is required because direct physical contact is there, and it is simple in construction and low in cost, does not require any cooling water pump, and less space is required and low maintenance cost. These are the advantages of the jet condenser. Now what are coming to disadvantages, it is condensate cannot be reused and less suitable for high capacity plants, and large lengths of pipes are required and the cost is more, and fourth one is loss of vacuum due to the leakage of air from the long pipings. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of the jet condensers. Now we will see what are the advantages and disadvantages of the surface condensers. Okay, so anyhow, surface condensers, there is no physical contact, therefore the condensate can be reused. That is the main advantage we have. And the vacuum is also more in case of, if you use surface condenser, the turbine can do more work because the steam can expand more time. Okay, for no mixing of the water. Okay, and any kind of feed water can be used because there is no direct contact, and it develops high vacuum, therefore it increases the efficiency of the plant, and it requires less floor area, less power to run the air extraction and water extraction pump, and the system is more efficient. The disadvantages are, it requires large quantity of the cooling water, and the system is complicated and costly, and requires large floor space since it is bulky. Thank you. With this, the condensers are completed.
Yes. Any doubts?
Hello, students.
Students, any doubt in condensers, jet condensers and surface condensers? We have two types. Okay. In jet condensers, we have a low level, high level, okay, and ejector type. In low level, we have parallel flow and counter flow. Whereas in the surface condensers, we have two types again, surface condensers. One is the surface condenser, second one is the evaporative condenser. In surface condensers, we have single flow, multi flow, okay, and central flow and down flow. And one is the evaporative condenser. So in evaporative condenser, it is similar to the 5-tube boiler. The ejected steam from the turbine is allowed to pass through the tubes, and outside the tubes, the water is sprayed. Thereby, due to the conduction as well as the convection, the steam will get condensed, and that can be reused. Okay, okay. We cannot reuse in case of evaporative system because Yes, we can reuse. Yes, we can reuse because there is no physical contact in case of surface condensers. Whereas in jet condensers, the condensate cannot be reused because of the physical contact. So apart from that, we have one short answer, that is boiler mounting and boiler access. He may ask in the exam, list out any 3 to 4 boiler mountings and what are the uses of that. Okay, so basically we know the boiler mountings are water level indicator, pressure gauge, safety valve, fusible plug, steam stop valve, okay, blow off cock, and feed check valve, manhole. So these are mountings, are mount, as we know, the mountings are for safety. Okay, so these mountings are located over the surface of the boiler. If you see any boiler, these mountings are located over the surface, right? Now, so the main purpose of one by one, we will see what is the use of the boiler mounting. So water level indicator. So water level indicator is used to check the water level inside the boiler. Okay, now if the water is not up to the mark, then by using feed pump, we will fill the water. Okay, so the boiler water level indicator, it allows the operator to check the level of the water available inside the boiler is up to the mark or not. Next, pressure gauge. Pressure gauge indicates the pressure of the steam developed within the boiler. Okay, pressure gauge indicates that the pressure of the steam within the limits or not. Okay, suppose if the pressure exceeds, then what is the one more mounting we have? Safety valve. Safety valve will allows the boiler to store the pressure up to the designed value. Suppose if the boiler pressure is designed to a pressure of 10 bar or 15 bar pressure, then if the pressure of the steam exceeds 15 bar, automatically this safety valve will actuate and it will release the excess pressure from the boiler so that it will safeguard the system. That is the advantage of safety valve. Then we have fusible plug. So the fusible plug is located over the boiler. So the main advantage is, suppose if there is no water in the boiler, so then what will happen? So due to the flue gases, the heat liberated by burning of the coal or oil, the flue gases will be liberated. So due to the flue gases, they carry higher temperature. If there is no water inside the boiler, what will happen? It will damage the system, right? Now it will burn the tube. Therefore, in order to avoid that one, there is no water inside the boiler, and if the temperature of the tubes are very high, at that time the fusible plug will melt and it will inject the water and it will cease the fire. Okay, so that is the purpose of fusible plug. And then one more mounting, we have steam stop valve. So what is the purpose of steam stop valve? So steam stop valve will stop the water content inside the steam. Okay, no? So from the steam stop valve, we can make use of the steam to the prime mover or turbine or wherever you want, okay, to the engine. Okay, from the steam stop valve, we can take the steam out. Okay, and blow off valve, one more, it is located exactly at the bottom of the boiler. So to remove any sediments present inside the boiler, any foreign material, dust particle, we can remove by using the blow off cock. Right, no? Then we have feed check valve. Feed check valve will allow the user to check the water inside the boiler. Okay, so means as we know from the water level indicator, we came to know that if the water is not up to the mark, then by using the feed check valve, we can fill the water into the boiler. Those are the boiler mountings we have. Apart from that, we have accessories. As we know, the accessories are to increase the efficiency of your boiler. Therefore, what are the accessories we discussed? Economizer we saw. Evaporator, sorry, nothing but superheater. Then we have steam separator, and feed pump is also a boiler accessory. So, right now, so accessories are located within the boiler, whereas mountings are located over the surface of the boiler. Remember, okay? And mountings are for safety, accessories are for increasing the efficiency. And coming to the size, the accessories are bigger compared to the mountings. Okay, but economizer, where we used economizer, right? So economizer is used to heat the feed water, right? Now, so before sending the water into the boiler, first by using the heat carried by the exhaust gases, we are using the exhaust gases to heat the feed water before sending into the boiler. What is the main advantage of economizer? Suppose if there is no economizer, the water will be supplied to the boiler at room temperature, let us say 30 degrees centigrade. So by using economizer, let us say if the temperature of the water is raised to 40 degrees centigrade, thereby what is happening? We are saving the cost of the fuel, because already 10 degrees is raised outside the boiler. Therefore, less amount of heat is required to increase the temperature from 40 to 100 as compared to the 30 to 100. Means the economizer is used to increase the efficiency of the boiler. So in this case, we can reduce the cost of the fuel. Okay, so that is the economizer. And we have one more thing, air preheater. That is also a accessory. Okay, now accessory, one more accessory, air preheater. Where air preheater is located? Air preheater is located at the top of the boiler. So where we are extracting the heat from the flue gases, and that heat we are using to increase the temperature of the air, that air we are supplying for the combustion. Okay, so that is the reason. Means if the air is dry, the combustion rate is faster. Okay, as we know in IC engines, the combustion has to complete at faster rate. Even 0.003 milliseconds is also ignition lag. If you remember, 3 milliseconds is also ignition lag, if you see in case of SI engine. Therefore, always the combustion has to complete in fraction of milliseconds. For that reason, if you supply dry air, the fuel can burn in no time. Therefore, high temperature of flue gases will be liberated. Okay, thereby the heat transfer rate will be more. So that is the reason we are using air preheater to preheat the air we are supplying to the combustion chamber. Okay, and then we are using superheater. So the superheater tubes are used to remove any moisture content present inside the steam. Thereby the steam, saturated steam, will be converted into superheated steam. Thereby there is no question of corrosion or erosion inside the blades of the turbine when the steam is expanded. Okay, always superheated steam consists of higher quality of the steam, therefore the higher pressure. In superheater, the heating of the steam will take place at constant pressure. Only the temperature of the steam will be raised, therefore any water vapor present will be eliminated. That is the purpose of superheater. Then steam separator we have. Steam separator is also an accessory. In steam separator, what we are doing? We are separating the water content from the steam, and that water we are draining by using the steam trap. Steam trap and steam separator, both are accessories. Steam separator will remove the moisture or water content from the steam, and that water will be drained by using the steam trap. Okay, right. Next, we are having feed pump. Feed pump is also comes under accessory, because by using feed pump, we can pump the water under higher pressure, thereby the heat transfer rate will be more. So this is about our boilers, mountings, as well as accessories. So the fourth unit will be of two subtopics we discussed. That is, one part is the part one is the boiler, part two is the condenser. In part one, that is under boiler, we discussed first fire tube boiler, then water tube boiler, then high pressure boiler. Again, we discussed condensers, then boiler mountings and accessories. This is about the fourth unit. Any doubts, please ask me in fourth unit. Students? Any doubt in this unit? We discussed boilers and condensers. There may be chances of two essays from this unit. One essay from the boiler, other essay from the condenser.
No, sir.
Right. So if we ask, let us say, for short answer, what are the differences between mountings and accessories? What you will answer? If you ask for short answer point of view, what is difference between boiler, mountings and accessories? What is your answer? The first answer, first difference would be, mountings are for the safety purpose. These mountings are located over the surface of the boiler. Okay. Whereas coming to the accessories are for increasing the efficiency or performance of the boiler, and these accessories are placed within the boiler. And compared to the size, accessories are bigger as compared to the mounting. That is the first difference we can see. Okay, no? And you can say boiler mounting is an essential part. It is required. Yes or no, right? So pressure, say, safety valve is required. Pressure gauge is required. Feed water level indicator is required. These are all essential parts of the boiler, because without that we can't know. We don't know whether the water present inside the boiler is up to the mark or not. Yes, sir, right? If the pressure level indicator is not there, we don't know whether the pressure developed within the boiler is up to the limits or not. These are all essential parts of the boiler. Whereas coming to accessory is not an essential part. They are used to only improve the efficiency. That is one difference we can say. And one more difference, that is these are mounted over the surface of the boiler and these are mounted inside the boiler. And we can say mountings are occupies less space and accessories occupies more space. These are the differences between mountings and accessories, we can say. Clear now? Very, very important for short answer. So we discussed the classification of boiler. That is also important for short answer. What is the purpose of superheater? What is the purpose of economizer? What is the purpose of air preheater? These are all the short answer questions. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. Next, we will see steam power plant, that is the fifth unit. So far, if you remember, right, we discussed boiler. So actually, in steam power plant, what are the main elements I told already? What are the main elements of steam power plant? What are the main elements of
boiler, turbine, condenser, and feed pump?
Boiler, turbine, condenser, and feed pump. Okay, no?
Today.
Right. So far, we discussed about boiler part, we discussed, then condenser part we discussed. Okay, no? And we are going to study about the turbines in the coming semesters. Okay, no? Right. So basically, our heat engines are, what is the basic cycle for heat engine? Please answer. We completed TD and we are about to complete ATD. What is the basic cycle for an IC engine or heat engine? What is the basic
fundamental cycle?
Yeah, what is the name of that one? We are source
Carnot
and Carnot cycle. Very good. Carnot cycle is the basic cycle for the heat engines, whereas coming to the power plants, the basic cycle is the Rankine cycle. Okay, it is similar to the Carnot cycle. Only thing is there are two operations are replaced by constant pressure. If you see, you will get it. Okay, so basically we have four elements. Out of that, we discussed about two elements in detail. One is the boiler, second one is the condenser, and the feed pump. Generally, we are using reciprocating or centrifugal pump. Basically, we are using centrifugal pumps. That is to pump the water. Nothing to worry about that. Only thing is the turbine part we will study in coming semesters. Okay, that is in hydraulic machines. Okay, so now we will see how a steam power plant works. What is the basic cycle, right now? So how to increase the efficiency of the steam power plant? What is the PV diagram? What is the TS diagram? So those things I will see. And if you recall the fourth unit of the TD, we discussed about pH diagrams, right now? So we have constant, let us say, entropy, what is that one? Psychrometric chart, okay? So left side, we have constant liquid line. And right side you have vapor line, in between you have single phase, two phase, everything we discussed. Let me recall those things.
Friends, this is the first video on steam power plant cycle. Okay. Right. So first we'll see what is the steam power plant, what are the main elements of the steam power plant, how they function. Okay. Now, basically, steam power plant consists of four elements. So boiler, turbine, condenser, and pump. So out of these four, we already discussed in details about the boiler and condensers. Okay. Now, here, in next coming semesters, you will study about the turbines as well as the pumps. Okay. Right. Now, so as we know, in boiler, we are converting the water into the steam by exchanging the heat. So boiler is a steam generator. We can call boiler also a steam generator. In the boiler, the water is converted into steam by using the hot gases. Okay. Now that steam generated in the boiler is going to expand in the blades of the turbine. Thereby, the shaft of the turbine rotates. Okay. So as we know, the application of the steam is to generate the power. Therefore, we are expanding the steam in the turbine. Thereby, the shaft of the turbine rotates, okay? If you see, this is the generator. The shaft of the generator is also coupled with the shaft of the turbine. Means whenever the turbine rotating, the shaft of the generator is also in rotation. Thereby, it produces electricity that electricity we can transmit with the help of the transmission lines. Okay. Now, after the expansion, so in the turbine, we know the steam is expanded till the condenser pressure. Okay. Right. Now, this steam is discharged into the condenser, thereby using the cooling water or feed water, converting the discharge steam into the feed water, and that feed water again we are feeding into the boiler. Okay. So, means these are the core elements of a steam power plant. Okay. Now we will see what is the basic cycle for this steam power plant. Okay. So, for any engine or cycle, the basic cycle is the Carnot cycle. Okay. As we know, in Carnot cycle, there are four processes: two isothermal process and two adiabatic process. Okay. So, isothermal compression, adiabatic compression, isothermal expansion, and adiabatic expansion. Okay. So, that Carnot cycle will give good results when it is operating between two fixed temperatures, that is source and sink. Okay. Right. Now, the Carnot cycle is not a suitable model for the steam power plant. Why? Because if you remember, you already studied in engineering thermodynamics, cyclometric chart, right? Now, you can see here, this line is the saturated liquid line and this line is the saturated vapor line, meaning that the state is liquid on this line, the state of the substance, and the state of the substance on this line is the vapor, okay? Now, at this point, where this saturated liquid line and saturated vapor line are intersecting, that is a critical point. Above that, it will behave as an ideal gas. Okay? Means left of this line will be liquid and right of this line will be vapor. And in between, we have two-phase mixture, that is the liquid plus vapor. Means point one state is pure liquid, point two state is vapor, and 3 and 4 are combination of liquid plus vapor. Okay. Now, you got this one, liquid line, vapor line, and critical point. This is a critical point, and it will behave as an ideal gas. And this is the two-phase mixture, that is the combination of liquid and vapor. Okay. So, as I mentioned, the Carnot cycle is not suitable for a steam power plant. Why? Because, so first one is, we are expanding the steam in the turbine, right? That is till to the condenser pressure. Okay. Now, if you expand to the lowest pressure, what will happen? So, inside the turbine and water will be formed. So, that water will corrode the blades of the turbine. Okay. That is the first problem. Due to the low quality, it will erode the corrosion, we can say, corrode the blades of the turbine. And it is impractical to design a compressor that handles two phase, meaning that now here you can see 2 to 3 is the expansion of the steam in the turbine, and 3 to 4 is the condensation, then 4 to 1 is the pumping the water into the boiler now, right? So at point 4, what is the state? It is liquid plus vapor. We don't have any device to pump a combination of two phase mixture, that is the combination of liquid plus vapor. So that is the reason it is difficult. Okay. It is difficult to pump the two phase mixture. Okay. That's what it is difficult. It is impractical to design a compressor that handles two phase mixture. Okay. And the next one more difficulty is, it is difficult to control the condensation process that precisely has to end up with the desired point 4, right? So it is not possible to stop at point 4. Okay. So these are the problems with the Carnot cycle. So the Carnot cycle cannot be applicable for the vapor cycle, right? So there are certain changes are there in Carnot cycle. So if you make changes, then we can call that as a Rankine cycle. Okay. So even in Rankine cycle also, we have four elements. So we have boiler, turbine, condenser, pump. Okay. So pump is the work consuming device because it is used to increase the pressure. That's why we are adding work input to the pump. And in the boiler, we are adding the heat, thereby it is converted into the steam. And in the turbine, we are getting the work, we are getting the work output. In the condenser, heat is removed. Okay. Right. So now this is the simple Rankine cycle. So we'll discuss what is process 1, process 2, process 3 and 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So basically, Rankine cycle consists of four processes similar to Carnot cycle. So here, isothermal processes are replaced by constant pressure process. Okay. So the difference between Carnot cycle and Rankine cycle is, in Carnot cycle, isothermal processes are replaced by the constant pressure process. Okay. Now, so first process 1 to 2. 1 to 2 is the compression. You can see one is here, 2 is here. 1 is before the pump, two is the after the pump. Means 1 to 2, we are pumping the water. We are increasing the pressure of the water to the boiler pressure. Means during this 1 to 2, what we are doing? We are adding the work to the pump. We are giving work input to the pump. Okay, that's what. Water enters the pump at state 1 as saturated liquid and is compressed to the operating pressure of the boiler by isentropically. Isentropic process is also called as reversible adiabatic process. Okay. Now 2 to 3, this is entry, is the entry to the boiler is 2, exit from the boiler is the 3. 2 to 3, what we are doing? We are adding the heat at constant pressure. We are adding the heat at the constant pressure. Okay. So that's what 2 to 3 is the constant pressure heat addition process. Here the saturated water enters the boiler at liquid phase and leave it as a superheated vapor at state 3. Means for the boiler, entry is the liquid state, exit is the vapor state, 2 to 3. Now 3 to 4 is the expansion of that superheated steam inside the turbine, 3 to 4. Okay. At 3 it is entering, at 4 it is leaving. Okay. So that is the isentropic expansion, superheated vapor expands isentropically in the turbine till the condenser pressure. Okay. Till the condenser pressure. Then at point 4, the exhaust steam from the turbine is entering into the condenser and at state 1 it is leaving. Okay. So 4 to 1 is the constant pressure heat rejection process. Okay. We are exchanging the heat from the exhaust steam to the condensate liquid. Okay. High quality steam is condensed in the condenser. Now we can see in TS diagram, as I told, this black line, this is a saturated liquid line and this is a saturated vapor line. And you can see this line inclined horizontal again. This is called constant pressure line. 2 to 3 line is called constant pressure line. On this line, wherever you pick a point, at that point pressure is constant. Got it? So the starting from 2 to, if you go like this, this line is called constant pressure line in psychrometric chart. So on that line, at any point, if you pick a point, there the pressure is constant.
Sir, it's not audible again.
From when?
Now, sir. Just now.
Point 4 is the?
Now it's audible, sir.
Vapor, okay, vapor line. This is superheated vapor, 0.3. Now 0.4 is the vapor. Okay. At 0.4, it is entering into the condenser. Now, if you see 4 to 1, it is a condensation process. If you go through the Carnot cycle, where is the 0.4 after condensation? What is the point? Where is the point? It is a two-phase mixture. But here after Rankine cycle, after condensation, the point is on saturated liquid. It is a single phase mix, single phase mixture. Okay, so therefore it is easy to handle the single phase mixture. Okay, that is the reason the Carnot cycle is not applicable for the steam power cycles. Okay, so isothermal process are replaced by constant pressure process. That cycle is called Rankine cycle. Got it? Now, so 1 to 2 is the work done on the pump, and 3 to 4 is the work done by the turbine. 2 to 3 is the heat added to the boiler. 4 to 1 is the heat rejected from the condenser. Okay. Now, if you analyze the energy equation, right? So you already studied about steady flow energy equation, right? What is steady flow energy equation? Total energy plus heat addition is equals to total energy plus work done, right? So you can define, say, enthalpy plus internal energy, right? Okay. Plus Q is equals to enthalpy plus internal energy plus work done. Okay, so the total energy is constant indirectly, steady flow energy equation, right? Now if you apply it to the pump, so right in the pump it is let us say isentropical process, there is no heat addition or deletion. therefore Q is equals to 0 for the pump. Therefore, at state 1 it is entering, at state 2 it is leaving. But where the enthalpy is more, at point 2, because the temperature is more, right? So therefore, work done on the pump is equal to difference of the enthalpy, that is higher enthalpy minus lower enthalpy, that gives the H2 minus H1, okay? This is the work done on the pump. Now, coming to the boiler, we are adding heat to the boiler, okay? Some 322, okay? At 2, heat is added, at let us say 2 is the starting point, 3 is the ending point, okay? So where the enthalpy is more, at the exit only always, right? So H3 minus H1 gives the amount of heat added. Again, in the boiler, there are no moving parts in the boiler. So therefore, we can assume work done in boiler will be 0. Because in the absence of moving parts, work done equal to 0. Therefore, heat added is H3 minus H2. Now again, turbine is an insulated one. It is, okay? It is an isentropic expansion. Q is equals to 0, okay? So then work done by turbine is equals to, at 3 it is entering, at 4 it is leaving. Where the enthalpy is more, 3 only, because the temperature is more, okay? It is a superheated steam and this is only saturated steam, okay? Because the point 4 is on saturated vapor line. Therefore, enthalpy is more at point 3. Therefore, H3 minus H4 gives the work done by the turbine, okay? Now, fourth one is the condenser. In the condenser, there are no moving parts. Therefore, work done is equals to 0. And it is easy to remove the heat from the system. Therefore, Q out is equals to higher enthalpy is 4 and lower enthalpy is 1, H4 minus H1, right? As we know, thermal efficiency is equals to work done by heat supplied. Or we can say that net work by heat supplied. What is net work? Net work means out of the work produced by the turbine, certain amount of work is consumed by the pump. Therefore, net work is equals to turbine work minus compressor work. Turbine work minus compressor work gives the net work divided by heat added. Heat addition is in the boiler. If you substitute, you will get the thermal efficiency, okay? So, in terms of enthalpies, okay? Now, you can see, you will get enthalpy. H1 is the enthalpy of water at P1. And small v, you can say, the pump work is also calculated as specific volume into pressure difference. H2 minus H1 is also equivalent to specific volume into difference of the pressure. So you will get 1 minus TL by TH, the enthalpy, 1 minus T2 by T1 in terms of Carnot cycle, if you want to say. The thermal efficiency is 1 minus T2 by T1, okay? So this is the ideal cycle, but actual cycles...
Okay, students, we will stop till now. Is it clear PV diagram for Rankine cycle?
Yes, sir.
Is PV diagram? In next class, we will discuss the deviation of actual cycles from the ideal cycles. Okay. Is it okay? Any doubts in today's class?
No, sir.
Okay, then you can take a break and we'll